Thank you very much for the introduction. I will give you a brief overview of modern epidemiology of hepatocellular carcinoma. This is a color-coded map that shows the incidence rates worldwide. Red is the highest. It clusters in Southeastern Asia and Sub-Saharan Africa, where hepatocellular carcinoma is predominantly related to hepatitis B. The rest you can just go with your eyes and see what color you like and map it to the country you think of. Primary liver cancer, most of it is hepatocellular carcinoma, has increased from around 430,000 cases per year to now 750,000 cases. So generally and globally, it is increasing. This summarizes the temporal trends in the three main regions of the world: Japan at the very top, the European Union in the middle, and US at the bottom. It shows that Japan by far has the highest rates of hepatocellular carcinoma, but they peaked around 2000 or so, and they've declined ever since, both in men and women. Shows that the European Union, admittedly a very heterogeneous group of countries, have largely flat incidence rates. The United States have increased since the 1970s and have slowed down a little bit. Irrespective of the area of the world that you look at, whether high incidence at the top of the slide or low incidence at the bottom of that, there is a remarkable men-to-women discrepancy where men are 2 to 4 times as likely to develop hepatocellular carcinoma, irrespective of the risk factor or the region. That important epidemiological findings has clinical ramifications because most of the practice guidelines for screening do incorporate a differential screening for hepatocellular carcinoma in men than women. I'm now going to shift to the United States. There's been a 3-time increase in the incidence of hepatocellular carcinoma in the U.S. since the 1980s or so. This cover of gastro represents 3 graphs from our recent paper showing an increase that affected most states, particularly southern and western states, and the state now that is leading the nation in the incidence of hepatocellular carcinoma is the state of Texas, followed closely by Hawaii. Digging deeper into the incidence rates of HCC in the U.S., I want to turn your attention to the top 3 lines in this slide, which reflect the age-adjusted incidence rates in groups in the state of Texas. The red line reflects the South Texas Latinos. Simply put, South Texas Latinos have the highest incidence and mortality related to hepatocellular carcinoma, a finding that I will discuss the meaning of and the reasons behind when I talk about non-alcoholic fatty liver disease and metabolic syndrome. The bottom 3 lines reflect the rates for the nation. I think it's an important part of setting a foundation to understand the epidemiology of hepatocellular carcinoma, and for that matter, its prevention, is understanding that the vast majority of HCC cases happen in the underlying circumstance or environment of having liver cirrhosis. Approximately 90% of cases arise in this setting. The 3 main reasons or etiological risk factors are hepatitis C, hepatitis B, or nothing. And if you look at all the studies that have been done in the United States, comparing the proportion of cases with the underlying etiology between 2000 to 2010, there's a typo there, noticing that hepatitis C is the only underlying etiological risk factor that has increased over time. Hepatitis B has remained steady. And then you have this whopping proportion of cases with hepatocellular carcinoma that do not have either hepatitis B or hepatitis C. And in most studies, they don't even have heavy alcohol consumption. I will talk about the reasons for that. So since hepatitis C is the dominant risk factor in the US, it is actually becoming on par with hepatitis B worldwide. And you see here different regions of the world: Europe, North America, Latin America, East Asia, West Asia, etc. And then there's, you have the total. There, the number of HCC cases reported in different studies, the proportion that are hepatitis C positive only, and the proportion where hepatitis C is positive with or without other biomarkers. And you can fast forward down here to 40%. In other words, 40% of HCC cases reported worldwide are positive for hepatitis C as the only risk factor, and almost 60% are positive for hepatitis C with or without the presence of something else. So it's clearly a dominant risk factor in many regions, but particularly in the US. I would have spent the entire talk a few years ago talking about the risk factors for HCC among those with HCV infected. I would have gone patiently and perhaps boringly through every one of those risk factors, modifiable or non-modifiable, etc. I'm not going to spend any time on that because the epidemiology of hepatitis C related HCC now is dominated by this modern picture of getting treated and receiving SVR. Almost all the risk factors that were previously listed on this slide lose most of their significance in the presence of a curative treatment. Hepatitis B, a lot has been done about the epidemiology of hepatitis B. This would have been one of many slides in the past that I described the epidemiology of HBV-related HCC. There are two messages from this slide. First, HBV DNA is the major driver of the risk of HCC, so higher rates have the highest HCC rates, while lowest HBV DNA have the lowest HCC rates. Cirrhosis remains the predominant risk factor, although 10% or so develop it in the absence of cirrhosis. So much so that the epidemiology of hepatitis B-related HCC translated into risk calculators, the most famous of which probably is the REACH-B model, where it integrates sex, age, ALT level, HBe antigen, and HBV DNA, and there were scores and things that you can calculate about the risk factor. But all of these things, with the exception of sex and age, are greatly modified by the effective HBV suppressive treatment right now, and therefore the epidemiology pre-HBV successful treatment rarely applies to what we have nowadays. Now I'm going to shift gears from viral hepatitis to obesity. There's a global epidemic of obesity. The US leads the way in that. Many countries are catching on. Obesity and HCC have been described in several studies, and if you're an obesity enthusiast, you would think that most cases are related to obesity, but this slide gives you perhaps a balanced view of the studies out there. Most of the studies, but not all, suggest a modest increase in the risk of HCC among obese people. A systematic review of 10 of the best design studies, that is cohort studies, show that positive association seen in 7 studies, from a very modest 1.4 to quite high 4.1. No association was seen in 2 studies, and actually one study showed an inverse association, where obesity was protective against HCC. They're all limited by the biases that I mentioned right here. And what you will see now is a move from obesity as defined by BMI, which is a very crude measure of whatever it is that obesity does to cause harm, and to more things that are called proximal associations. Proximal associations like abdominal fat, as opposed to BMI, humoral mechanism like inflammatory markers, non-alcoholic steatohepatitis, as opposed to talking about just obesity. So, for example, studies examining waist-hip ratio, as opposed to BMI, has conferred more or less a consistent association with an increased risk of HCC. This particular study, which is a multi-center, multi-country population-based study in Europe, showed a 3-time increase in the risk of HCC in those on the highest tertile of waist-hip ratio. The study shows a removed face here because this was me a few years ago, and now I look like this. You could check it out. Diabetes, as the possible other manifestation of metabolic syndrome has been associated with approximately twofold increase in the risk of hepatocellular carcinoma. This is one of many cohort studies that have been done to show this remarkably consistent finding where diabetes increases the risk of HCC. This summarizes the literature about diabetes and HCC, at least 25 cohort studies, and a remarkable consistency in the risk estimates, which is two or approximately doubled. Things that are important to remember, those treated with metformin seem to be at a particularly lower risk of HCC. Almost all the studies deal with type 2 diabetes, and the finding is consistent irrespective of geography, history of cirrhosis, or alcohol consumption, or viral hepatitis. Now I'm going to talk about the third proximal mechanism. So I talked about waist-hip ratio, talked about diabetes, talked about now I'm going to talk about NAFLD as a way of explaining the association between obesity and HCC. You're familiar with NAFLD, which is steatosis that may progress to non-alcoholic steatohepatitis in 20 to 25% of the time, which may progress to cirrhosis, and once you have cirrhosis, the risk increases dramatically. So I will mention a little bit about what evidence do we have for this progression. I will also talk a little bit about this new entity of NAFLD moving to HCC without cirrhosis, or NASH moving to HCC without cirrhosis. So the epidemiological evidence linking NAFLD to HCC can be summarized in one slide. If you're looking for the gold standard, which is population-based cohort studies, you'll be disappointed. There's not much evidence. There are only two studies. One shows no association at all, and one shows a weak one. If you go to the next level of studies, which is clinic-based cohort studies of NAFLD or NASH, the risk starts creeping up, but a little bit only. Varies between nothing to 6% over 20 years of follow-up. The association gets really consistent and strong when you look at clinic-based cohorts of NAFLD-related cirrhosis. There, the risk is around 1% per year, which is high, quite high, but lower than that of hepatitis B or hepatitis C. What about HCC in the absence of cirrhosis? There have been many surgical series describing this entity, and the accusation of those surgical series that they have a selection bias where the only people referred to resection would be the ones with no or minimum liver disease. So they may not represent what is happening out there. However, in a study where we looked at 1,500 cases with hepatocellular carcinoma diagnosed in the national VA system and performed a rigorous chart review in which we defined the absence of cirrhosis at the time of HCC diagnosis as very highly probable, in other words, there was a biopsy that shows no cirrhosis, or highly probable where the clinical, biochemical, and radiological features were not suggestive of cirrhosis. So basically, around 13%, but as low as 3% of all comers with HCC in the VA system may not have underlying cirrhosis. What characterizes this group? The only main feature that came out is they're five times as likely to have had NAFLD or cryptogenic cirrhosis before their diagnosis, and they're almost never likely to have hepatitis C or hepatitis B. So this is a slide that epidemiologists like to show, and I'll put it, the three risk factors in context. The first column is the prevalence, how common the risk factor in the population. Second one is the risk estimate, how strong the risk factor. And the third one is population attributable fraction. This refers to the percentage of HCC that could be wiped out the face of the earth if you get rid of the underlying risk factor. So in the case of hepatitis C, for example, it's really not that common in the underlying population, only 1 to 2%. It is quite a powerful risk factor, so the risk is increased 20 to 25-fold. And the population attributable fraction, which is an equation that incorporates both the prevalence and risk estimates, is 20 to 25%. If you look at the metabolic syndrome, or for that matter, NAFLD, the prevalence is quite high in the general population. The risk estimate is quite low. It's a very weak or modest risk factor. But you can crank up a lot of population attributable fraction by having a weak risk factor that is very common, just as you can do with an uncommon risk factor that is very strong. So what is actually happening in reality? Reality doesn't seem to mirror the doom and gloom scenario of NAFLD-related HCC. So these are relatively recent data from the VA, shows the temporal changes in the underlying risk factor in newly diagnosed HCC between 2005 and 2010. And it shows in the blue bars that the HCV-related proportion continues to increase. The red proportion is alcohol-related. NASH is 8 to 10%, and it's steady, at least during this time period. So why did that not translate from the population attributable fraction? It's two reasons, not mentioned on this slide. But one of them is the population attributable fraction assumes that every case that develops in an obese person is obesity related, and this may not be true. Second, the population attributable fraction does not consider temporal lag or latency. So this may happen in 30 or 40 years if that's how long it takes. But right now, it's still not there yet. How do we translate the epi to prevention? One of the largest victories of epi and prevention has been the HBV vaccination in areas where HCC is endemic. For example, the Taiwan experience, where the introduction of universal vaccination for infants and children has resulted in a significant decrease in adolescent and now in young adults with HCC. I think the thing that I want to leave you with, that the world of hepatocellular carcinoma, at least arising in modern Western clinics, is a world of successfully treated chronic viral hepatitis. I would say most patients in my clinic have no active hepatitis. They're either adequately suppressed HBV or cured hepatitis C or NAFLD. So what happens after you cure people with hepatitis C? In my view, which is highly biased because this is our study, this is the best study out there that shows what happens to the risk of HCC after you cure hepatitis C with the new DEAs. So this is in the national VA system, 23,000 so started DEA, 2,500 completed DEA treatment and did not have any prior evidence of HCC. Of those, a large proportion, as you may expect, had SVR, a small proportion, but because we have so many of them, translates into a large number of people, had no SVR. 88 cases of HCC developed in this group and 183 in the SVR group. And putting this in a Kaplan-Meier curve gives you two things. The red line is the incidence of HCC in those treated with DEAs but did not get SVR. And it's remarkably higher than those who got treated and received SVR. So treatment still confers major drastic reduction in HCC. The second thing is there are no blibs in this line. There hasn't been an immediate increase in HCC or a delayed unexpected risk in HCC and SVR. So I know previous reports have alluded to that. We could not verify an unusual increase in HCC following cure. I should go back here and say it's not flat. In other words, there's some increase in SVR, and not mentioned on this slide, it's almost exclusively related to those who at the time of the cure had underlying liver cirrhosis. So I want to conclude by saying the global burden of HCC is, has been, and remains large. There are remarkable disparities in geography, gender, or race. I brought up the example of the US as one from many examples that you can go around the world and examine. In the US, it is now the fastest rising cause of cancer-related deaths. Cirrhosis remains the main underlying lesion, with or without cure of viral hepatitis. Hepatitis B and hepatitis C are the two main risk factors worldwide. There's a lot that can be talked about that is modifiable and non-modifiable, but the main thing now is cure of hepatitis C or suppression of hepatitis B. There's a possible role for NAFLD and NASH. That role is probably small, but given how common this risk factor, it may translate, but haven't yet translated into a large number of HCC cases. the epidemiology has translated into a few useful things like HBV prevention. Now there's a lot that needs to be done figuring out how HCC, if it develops in whom, after receiving treatment with viral hepatitis. I didn't talk much, but there's some studies relating to metformin, statins, and coffee. This is my last slide. Thank you again for the invitation.